Well, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Welcome to Bunker Hill Community College, and welcome to tonight's forum for gubernatorial candidates on issues affecting immigrations and immigrant communities. My name is Pam Ettinger, and I'm the president of Bunker Hill. We're very pleased to host and co-sponsor this conversation tonight. Immigrants are the single fastest growing demographic in our Commonwealth, which now includes over 1 million residents from 100 nations. That's 15% of our residents and 18% of our workforce. Bunker Hill Community College, with our 14,000 students, closely reflects this growing trend. We have students from 100 countries speaking 75 languages. So what are the issues that are impacting our immigrant communities in the urban areas of Massachusetts, you will see in our microcosm. Be it language acquisition, educational opportunities, housing, health and welfare, or balancing acculturation and immigration with the preservation of home cultures and practices that makes us unique and uniquely American. While immigrants play a key role in the economic and social history of our state, we are frequently viewed as burdens, easily forgotten, and sometimes maligned. Even when immigrants stand up, as they did Thursday when 1,000 marchers shut down Boylston Street over the issue of housing minors fleeing Central America, it is hard to attract the attention of mainstream media. So we welcome the candidates for the top office of our great Commonwealth tonight to speak to those issues. Bunker Hill is pleased to serve as that marketplace of ideas where our candidates can tell us about their vision of America's promise and delineate the path to get there. Now, I would like to thank a long list of co-sponsors, and by the very diversity and richness of this list, communicate to our candidates that this is a vital issue for our Commonwealth. So tonight, we thank MIRA, the Massachusetts Immigrant and Refugee Advocacy Coalition, who is the main anchor for tonight's event, the American Civil Liberties Union of Massachusetts, Emerson College's Elmer Lewis Center for Civic Engagement, Healthcare for All, the Massachusetts Alliance of Portuguese Speakers, the Massachusetts Law Reform Institute, Mass Vote, and we also want to note that this venue is endorsed by English for New Bostonians, the Immigrant Lab at Boston College, and the Massachusetts Association of Hispanic Attorneys. Now, our audience should note that tonight's program is being live streamed and photographed by Emerson College. So for those of you who are camera shy, please note where our cameras are so you can avoid them. Now, let me introduce to you our moderator for our conversation tonight, Mr. Philip Martin. Mr. Martin is the senior investigative reporter for WGBH-FM. And since joining WGBH in 2010, Mr. Martin has reported on human trafficking in Southern New England, carbon offset schemes, police training in race, the Occupy movement, and the fishing industry in New England. He is a regular panelist on WGBH TV for Basic Block and an occasional panelist for Beat the Press. As you can see, Mr. Martin does not shy away from issues and has for many, many years injected a caring and probing voice into local and national journalism. His story on human trafficking has earned him an Edward R. Murrow Award, and that would be his second in his career. So please help me welcome Mr. Philip Martin.
Thank you, Dr. Ettinger. Look, folks, I know this setting, it looks like I want to say, come on down, you know, but this is a very serious event tonight. It's the only gubernatorial candidates debate that's focused on immigration. Immigration is an emotional issue, and we know it very well because of the makeup of our own community, as Dr. Ettinger just said. And it's also been brought to light in a very fundamental and emotional way because of what's been happening on the U.S.-Mexico border of late. There's always something happening on the U.S.-Mexico border, but of late, of course, it's focused greatly on children, and has provoked outcry on many sides of this this contentious issue. Here in Massachusetts, of course, we have our own issues and policies affecting the immigrant communities. I will be inviting the six candidates to join me, one at a time, for 15 minutes each, and there are four questions. We're going to stick strictly to this timetable. It's very important. And to stick strictly to this timetable, we have the lady with the best name in the House, Summer. Summer, if you could stand up for just a second. Summer is going to basically be keeping time. And we're going to we're going to stick closely to this schedule. Now, obviously, there are a lot of questions that we would like to ask, but there are four questions that we're going to definitely ask of our distinguished candidates. And we're going to begin with Don Berwick, who's a pediatrician by trade, who most recently served as President Obama's head of Medicaid and Medicare, and is now seeking to win the Democratic primary for governor. Dr. Berwick, if you would join me here. Set up my own microphone. I wouldn't be the reporter that I hope I am without trying to record this myself, would I? Folks, first of all, I want to welcome all of you. And I'm going to also ask you to, you can certainly applaud, but I'm going to ask you to restrain from questions or insertions or anything of that sort. We're going to focus on the candidates and their questions and answers. I'm going to start with a story. As a reporter, we tell stories. And this story is about a fella named Josue. And he's a member of the Committee de Vecinos in Fitchburg. Now, he was driving home one night, one late afternoon, I should say, from a picnic. And he was with his wife, five children, and he was stopped by the state police. And they told him his registration had expired. As they looked into it, apparently his registration had not expired. However, he was driving without a license. That's obviously problematic. And so he was taken into police custody. Now, immigration officials issued a detainer to the police, and Josue was held in detention, immigration detention, for 5 months. This gentleman was released with an ankle bracelet in August of last year, around this time, after a major public outcry from various communities asking that he be allowed to keep his family together and not be held in detention, not be deported. Now, tomorrow, Josue will go to an appointment with ICE, and he's worried that he may be ordered to leave the country, and of course, in leaving the country, he leaves his family. So we understand that his children, and this is not surprising, have suffered psychologically from this traumatic experience, and that his family is terrified of the police more than ever. So the question I ask you, sir, if governor, what would you say to Josue, and how would you use your position to ensure that Massachusetts public safety policies promote the safety of all residents and do not lead to family separation or what some consider racial profiling in this regard?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me here. I very much appreciate it. My brother went to Bunker Hill Community Colleges and benefited greatly from it, so I appreciate the host. And Mira, it's a very important set of topics we're talking about. My campaign is based on values that I think we need to recenter the country on. Social justice, equality, compassion. Those are the three words I keep repeating. What I think I've been taught is there's no such thing as an illegal person. And once someone like this man is among us, they have human rights, and we have to protect them. The Secure Communities Act is misnamed. It's an Insecure Communities Act. It causes the kind of fear that story would invoke in anyone here that was afraid of their status here. I support the Trust Act. My endorser, Senator Jamie Eldridge, is a sponsor. I applaud what Mayor Curtatone has done in Somerville on implementing the Trust Act administratively. If I were governor, I would encourage that to happen all over this Commonwealth. People need to know they can live securely and not in fear. And if they're among us, they are of us. and I feel deeply about that. And this plays out in so many ways that I've now seen on the campaign trail in, for example, the tremendous inequity and violence in our own alleged criminal justice system. An African American in this state has 9 times the chance of being in prison as a white. Latino has 6 times the chance. We have the constant patterns of undercutting equality of access, especially for people of color, people, immigrant communities, and people among us who really need help. And that man needs help, and as governor, he'll get it.
Now, how exactly would you help him, you say, as governor?
First of all, I think we need to implement the Trust Act in this state. If not, we can't do it through the legislature. If the legislature approves it, it has to be done administratively. We need people to feel secure. They have to access to driver's licenses, in-state tuition. We have to create opportunities for people like this man so that he can enter the economy. He needs help to make sure that his opportunities to participate in the economy are real and there. And as governor, I'll be supporting vocational training programs, job training programs, English language learning, if that's relevant, so he has a pathway into the economy and isn't sectored off, isn't regarded as other.
Okay, thank you. Let's move to the next question. And this question is focused on the New Americans Agenda, which you may have heard about. Massachusetts has had a long history of integrating immigrants from all areas of the world, represented by the folks in this very room from everywhere, including refugees who fled for their survival, those who've benefited from being home to one of the most diverse immigrant populations in the nation. Dr. Berger, what policies would you put in place as governor to discourage nativist legislative proposals like those we've seen in Arizona and in Georgia, and frankly, some of the proposals that have occurred here in Massachusetts? And what policies would you put in place to position new Americans, to succeed in our state?
Well, it begins in the administration, positioning people from the immigrant communities in the administration. If I'm governor, we will have an administration that reflects the complexion and the background of this Commonwealth. People need to feel that they're heard and can participate. So many people around this Commonwealth, when I leave the room, say, don't forget us. They feel forgotten. For immigrants, they're a mainstay of our economy. 1 million people here, 15% of our population, 18% of our workforce, 60% of the businesses, the new businesses in Massachusetts are started by first-generation immigrants. They need help. Among the forms of help are language access. Half of the immigrants in this state have trouble with language to get into the economy, and we have 20,000 people on waiting lists for English as a second language learning and for appropriate instruction to be able to get into the economy. As governor, I will make sure that waiting list is cleared and people don't have language as a barrier. New immigrant businesses need support. They need help to get set up. They will have that help if I'm governor. They also, in some cases, will need assistance in negotiating through licensing and zoning laws. So I'm going to foster immigrant businesses. They're extremely important to our economic future.
Okay, I switched the questions up a little bit, but you've transitioned perfectly because this question is about inclusive access to state services, including language access. So if elected governor, what would you do to ensure your administration is compliant with language access requirements and that all residents can access public information and communicate with all state agencies? And how would you sustain Massachusetts' commitment to inclusive access to healthcare, education, and social services, perhaps elaborating as you started to do?
Yeah, I would treat it at least 2 tiers, adult access and K-12 education. It's really important for people to have access, and language as a barrier is really a key issue. So for the adult population here of immigrants, we need to beef up, we need to have an adequate supply of education to get into the economy with English as a second language, English acquisition skills, and as I say, assistance in businesses. They need access to our public higher education system here. The average age of someone using a community college in this Commonwealth is 29 years. Adults use it. And to be able to support a place like Bunker Hill, to have the resources to bring people in, help them in their own language, and then transition them to English, as I assume they want to, is a crucial investment for this Commonwealth. In K-12 education, we have the same kind of barriers. We need a targeted approach, but we need schools that where kids are having trouble with language acquisition because English isn't their first language, those schools need multilingual capabilities. You know, the dropout rate of Latino kids in our school system, K-12 school system, is 25%. And that is partly their lack of comfort with being in the classroom. They're coming in without the language skills that they need. It's also, of course, poverty. And I want to say something really important, which is if you drill down but beneath the problems that immigrant communities have in getting into our economy, whether they're documented or undocumented, it's poverty that's at the root of this. And my administration and my run for governor is extremely focused on the relief and I hope the end of poverty in this Commonwealth, hunger and homelessness and the barriers that immigrant communities particularly face. And we have to work very hard to make sure that the attitude of the Commonwealth is to regard poverty as intolerable. 34% of immigrants live below 200% of the federal poverty line. And I'll say one other thing. I'm the only candidate for governor opposed to casinos and for the casino repeal. Casinos are predators on people in poverty and predators, therefore, on immigrant communities. They have no business being in this state. It's time to make sure we stop them with the approval of the referendum on November 4th to take away the casino law.
You've obviously thought about this quite a bit. Let me ask you if you've thought about this as well. I can't imagine not having the ability to get from point A to point B. And safe driving is a huge issue, of course, within immigrant communities. Do you support allowing all Massachusetts residents to participate in the driver's licensing process regardless of immigration status? This, of course, is controversial. And if yes, what specifically would you do as governor to ensure that Massachusetts adopts such a policy?
I'd follow the example of 12 other states that have adopted the policy. Absolutely, all people here, including undocumented residents, need access to driver's license. In my administration, they will have driver's license. They'll be able to get them without fear that will result in reports to ICE or any enforcement. This creates safer driving, because you need to demonstrate that you have vision and can drive and know the laws if you have a driver's license. It means people will be less frightened if they get into trouble. Right now, an undocumented person who gets into trouble without a driver's license is going to flee the scene. We don't want that. Insurance has to be adequate. It makes sense. It certainly makes sense as a matter of human right for us to welcome undocumented residents into the mainstream here, but it also makes sense for the rest of us who want a safe and orderly society. I have no question about that. I'll say one other thing. You're asking about driving, but mass transportation counts too. This state is way behind in adequate mass transportation services, and if you're living closer to the poverty line at lower levels of income, that's maybe your only option, and I think it's a very important investment for the well-being of immigrant communities in this Commonwealth, those of lower means, to make sure that we invest in a modernized, completely fit transportation system that extends the ability to move around where people want to get to and from their homes and their work.
Dr. Berg, thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Okay, our next candidate is Evan Falchuk. He's an independent and a longtime healthcare entrepreneur and executive, and now a founder of the United Independent Party, under whose banner he's running for governor. Sir, it's a pleasure.
Thank you.
All right. You heard the story that I mentioned earlier about the fellow driving home from the picnic with his wife and children and being stopped by the state police. And I guess this is the same question I would ask you, which is, the key part of the story is he was detained by ICE, held for 5 months. It was a campaign begun by other immigrants and non-immigrants who basically helped free this individual. Now he's worried, and he heads to an appointment tomorrow. He's worried about actually being not only detained but deported. If governor, what would you say to this gentleman, Josue, and how would you use your position as governor to ensure that Massachusetts public safety policies promote the safety of all residents and do not lead to family separation and what many consider racial profiling.
Absolutely. Well, let me start with another story, which is about my own father, who came to this country from Venezuela and became a doctor and was able to be successful. I know that the opportunities that he had available to him were possible. Yeah, he worked very hard, but also his skin was white like mine. So he didn't face the same kinds of disparities that we see happening in our society. And it covers so many different areas. And when you hear a story like Josue's story of being stopped, I'm not sure why, but there's been plenty of data that show that a lot of these stops are racially out of whack. You know, the police are stopping people of color more so than they are someone who looks like me. And when we don't talk about these things from a public policy standpoint, they fester. And maybe it's because we're too polite, or maybe because we're afraid that the issue is controversial, but either way, it reflects a very broken political process. His case, I mean, it's heartbreaking, because what we're dealing with is a federal government that has utterly failed us on this issue of immigration, completely failed us. It has a set of policies that don't make sense. They don't reflect the reality of the people that are here. It's tied to what we see in so many different issues, which is what I would call cowardly political leaders who want to make cheap political points over people's lives. So what could a governor do to stop the federal government from deporting Josue? Maybe not very much, if we're being honest about it. It's the federal government coming to deport someone. The state could try to block it from happening, and I think, in fairness, that you'd want to see that kind of justice be done. But it doesn't address that underlying fundamental issue of what kind of policies do we have in place where people are being stopped, detained for 5 months, separated from their families, and then deported from our country.
So obviously you're talking about not just about policy, you're talking about the tone as well, the tone of the discussion, which also again leads to this, but policy of course is that which constructs the type of attitudes that might occur within society. You can only construct those attitudes through particular policies. And I'm wondering, if elected government, what would you do to ensure your administration? What would you do to ensure that your administration is compliant with language access requirements, for example, as a policy, and that all residents can access public information, communicate with all state agencies, that no one is left out? How would you sustain Massachusetts' commitment to inclusive access, for example, to healthcare, education, and social services?
Look, the Civil Rights Act requires that we do a lot of these things. So we have to. We just have to. To the extent we're not, and there's lots of cases where we're not doing as good a job as we should, we've got to do more. I know the Department of Transitional Assistance has a pretty thoughtful plan on how to make sure that people who may not understand the ins and outs from a language perspective of what they need to do to apply for benefits, that they do a pretty good job of making sure that there are interpreters available for people who might need them. I think the bilingual ballot initiative, which is a huge step forward to make sure that people are able to vote, and I'm talking about citizens, to feel comfortable, because we have these very complicated ballot initiatives. You know, I wish they would translate them into plain English as well as into whatever other language is appropriate. But it's a meaningful, important step to take that recognizes the reality of what's here. But what needs to happen is we have to have leadership that's willing to talk about these things. The politicization of these things and the decadence of a political process that thinks it's okay to politicize these issues. You mentioned before this issue of the migrant children. And what we saw was, and I supported the governor's decision to say that Massachusetts should help the federal government in dealing with this humanitarian problem. Remember, this is a law signed by President Bush that's at issue that says that the kids need to have hearings before we determine what should happen to them. And what happened, unfortunately, was that on one side, and I thought it was unfortunate the way the governor described it, he compared it to turning around a ship full of kids fleeing from the Holocaust, which I don't think was helpful. And on the other side, we saw this appalling use of, there was a rally in front of the State House, people chanting things like, "No way, Jose." You know, what's going on here? What's happening to our country where this is the level of political discourse that we're putting ourselves through? And there are candidates who are here tonight who have sought to make cheap political gain at these people's expense. Where are they today on these issues? Now that Massachusetts isn't going to be hosting these children,
Well, that's a question that we will have to ask you. We know your position, so we'll have to ask the other candidates that question as well.
I'll hang out with you for a while.
No. Okay. Now, the New Americans Agenda, important term, New Americans. So, now, Massachusetts, as you know, has had this long history of integrating immigrants. Somalia, the former Soviet Union, Russia, Ukraine, Central America, we've seen this, including refugees who fled here for their own survival. And they've benefited from being home to one of the most diverse immigrant populations in the nation. What policies would you implement, sir, as governor to discourage what some consider nativist legislative proposals?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'd veto any kind of nativist legislative proposal that made it to my desk. I think you can tell by the way I talk about these issues that I would be discouraging them by just talking about them and saying, holding people to account when they start to take nativist tones around these issues. We've got a history of integrating people. We also have a pretty bad history of not integrating people, or perhaps even segregating people in Massachusetts. And we should be aware of that history when we think about the way we talk about issues of immigration. I see immigration as this huge opportunity. There are people that want to come here and make a better life, which is what so many people that have come to this country did. And they're doing it now, even today. So I see programs, I don't see new immigrants as they're often portrayed as helpless victims that need our assistance. Sometimes they do, but these are hardworking people that are providing all kinds of economic value to the Commonwealth, if you have to think about it in those terms. The state has a role to play. I've worked with a great community development corporation called Interise up in Lawrence, because I speak Spanish, and they're working with entrepreneurs that are there in the city of Lawrence, small businesses, really hardworking people, maybe need some technical assistance and skills, but the state has a great role to play in helping those businesses grow and thrive and prosper. Those are the seeds that get planted that turn into thriving, blossoming communities.
Safe driving. And by the way, I could tell you speak good Spanish because you helped me with my pronunciation. Thank you very much.
That's a Portuguese name, so
My second language, Portuguese. That's right. Now, do you support allowing all Massachusetts residents to participate in the driver's licensing process regardless of immigration status? And if yes, what specifically would you do as governor to ensure that Massachusetts adopts such a policy?
That's the international symbol
for international driver's license. Driving, that's right.
Yes, I support it. And as a governor, what I would want to do is propose legislation so that it would pass, so that we could make this into a reality. To me, this is a pretty straightforward thing, because we've got two classes of drivers now on the road. We've got people that are licensed and insured and have taken a driver's test, and we've got people who have not. And the argument ends up being this strange thing about whether it's, you know, the right to a driver's license versus these that we're rewarding people for illegal activity. So, you know, at that point, you say, why should we have any laws? You know, if a person is, you know, they say, why would the person get a driver's license if they're already breaking the immigration laws to be here? Well, then why don't they get to do whatever they want, right? No, it doesn't make any sense. So we have to have that available. It's a public safety issue. It's pretty straightforward. I mean, there's even studies that show that the Commonwealth would make money off of it because of the driver's license fees, which are pretty high as it is. But that's not the reason to do it. It's public safety. It's pretty straightforward. Everyone should be licensed.
Of course, some people argue differently. They think that it exacerbates problems already on the streets.
Yeah, it's an interesting argument. I mean, I think the underlying point of that argument is if we just wish hard enough and close our eyes and just really hope that things change, that people that are here and living in our communities will just disappear. But they're here, and they're part of our communities. So the choices we have as adults, and this is the thing, and I remind voters of this all the time, America is about self-government. It means when we have difficult issues, there's no king or queen getting on a boat to come over here. When we have difficult issues, we have to either deal with them ourselves, or they don't get dealt with. Or maybe people who don't share good views about other human beings will be the ones who decide. When we see that only 27% of voters voted in last year's election, when we see that a majority of the representatives in our legislature who did not pass that safe driving bill are running unopposed, there's something wrong with our democracy. These issues should be straightforward. The appalling failure of our federal government to deal with the issue of immigration in a comprehensive way is something that should be a serious wake-up call, as if we need more wake-up calls about the need to actually take back control over the way that our government works. They're on vacation now as these problems continue. And it's not right.
Evan Falchuk.
Thank you.
Thank you. Independent.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Okay, as I mentioned, we're moving right along here. Four questions, six candidates. Our next candidate is Mark Fisher, who is running in the Republican primary for governor. He's a self-declared Tea Party member and the owner of a small metal manufacturing plant in Auburn. Mark? Thank you very much.
Don and Evan, we're given a chance for their two-minute closing, so I don't want to have an advantage over them.
Oh, here's what we're going to do. We are, they are, okay. You're absolutely right. That was a remiss on my part. I thought we were, I had collapsed that into the time. But I think they did a pretty good job of stating their position, wouldn't you?
Yes.
Yeah, yes. Okay, we're fine. All right, Mark Fisher, the question, you've heard the question, I mean, it's been repeated before. You even know this fellow's name by now. And so I guess this whole notion of driving home from a picnic with your wife and children, suddenly pulled over by the state police, and you're placed in detention, I have no doubt that many people here have feared that from time to time. The notion of out of the blue, you end up in detention. I'm wondering, as governor, what would you say to this gentleman who was pulled over, held in detention, freed in August 2013 as a result of a public campaign, wanting desperately to stay with his family, and seeing that that possibility might be drifting away, and tomorrow he has a hearing with immigration officials. What is the best policy, in your view, as governor, and the tone to set, and the statement that you would make to this gentleman?
So with Jose, he's fearing deportation. And in the story that you told, it's not quite clear the reason that immigration is considering deportation. It's not because he didn't have a driver's license. If it is, we should all be rushing to his defense. If it's something more serious, and let's say that he's here illegally in the country, well, then we have to ask the question, should anyone be deported? Are there reasons for deportation? If no, we should all be rushing to his defense. If there are some reasons for deportation, and let's say this is because he's here illegally in this country, then Josue made the decision when he came here with his family and with his children that this was a risk that he took. And maybe the great advantages that this country holds out were worth that risk. But what I say is this, the bond between a parent and a child is much stronger than the bond between any state and any individual. If immigration feels that by enforcing the law, they will have to deport Josue, he will have to make that decision whether the benefits of this country are so great that he would want his wife and his family to stay here. Or is that bond between him and his family and his children greater, and he takes them with him, and maybe in a country that doesn't have the greatest benefits that we do, but still the love between that family spurs them on in any given situation. Again, I don't know the situations that he's being considered for deportation, and we're gonna get into this in the following questions, but I make a distinction, and I don't think we can go forward on solutions for this immigration issue unless we come to agreement that is legal immigration the same thing as illegal immigration? Obviously, I don't think it is, and we have to come to some consensus on whether or not it is.
Is there a consideration for his children in this regard, regardless of what the legal status might be, legal or illegal? How would you take the impact on his family in consideration as governor?
Yeah, I think that that's Josue's consideration. Again, if he's allowed to stay here, then obviously they stay here as well. But if he's deported, he has to make that decision that I talked about. He has to consider his family and whether it's better for them to stay here without him or whether it's better to remain as a family regardless of any situation, in any dire situations? Is it better to them to stay as a family? And that's a situation or decision for Josue, not for the governor of Massachusetts.
If his, deportation is predicated on his status, that is to say on what might be determined, and again, a lot of the facts aren't in, if it's determined that his status is illegal, should he be deported? And would you support that as governor?
Yeah, here's the thing. Again, it goes back to the situation. Are there reasons for deportation, and is being coming into this country illegally one of them? I would say yes. This is a difficult situation. But a country without borders is not a country at all. I employ 7 employees. 2 of them are immigrants. They've come here legally. One just obtained her green card. The other one just informed me last week that he passed his citizenship test, and he's waiting to find out where he goes for his oath of citizenship. That's entirely different from someone who goes around and doesn't follow that same path. It dishonors them. And I think there is a difference. We have to recognize there's a difference between being legal and illegal.
Okay. So let me ask you this question. Moving to topic 2, about inclusiveness of access to state services, including language access. Now, if elected governor, what would you do to ensure that your administration is compliant with language access requirements and that all residents can access public information and communicate with all state agencies, whatever they might be? And how would you sustain Massachusetts' commitment to inclusive access to health care, education, and social services?
Great question. The other candidates have had to answer it. And as they were answering, I was looking up behind us. One of the endorsers is the Immigrant Integration Lab at Boston College. And I want to focus on integration. I think we need to say that in the United States, English, it's not the law of the land that it's the language of the land, but it's what we use. It's what immigrants in the past have had to learn in order to integrate into our society. So I would foster any opportunity and more opportunities for them to learn the language, but not to keep the training wheels on longer than they're needed. Let's raise the bar. I believe in the goodness of people, that they want to be integrated into society, and give them all the opportunities to do so by helping them to learn the language that's common. Not legally the law of the land, but the common language here, so they can integrate better.
Now, Mr. Fisher, there's a desperation, of course, that is implicit in modern immigration. We see, as we see on the border of U.S., it's always been true, of course, but we see on the U.S.-Mexico border. That question was asked here by one of your fellow candidates about your position or toward the children who are coming across the border and what Massachusetts might have done at one point, which was basically to represent the federal government's, basically allow the federal government access. Let's try that again. That would basically set up housing that would be facilitated by the federal government on a temporary basis. What's your view on that?
Yeah, I said at the rally that Evan mentioned that we are a compassionate people. We are a compassionate people. We are already housing over 200,000 illegal immigrants. And when I listen to the mayors of our cities and towns and how dysfunctional they're becoming because they're being overburdened with services, I'll go back to this. When I came here tonight, when I got on the elevator and came up to the 3rd floor, I opened the doors open and there's a sign in the elevator and it says capacity, 5 people. I don't know what the capacity is, if there's a hard number for the state or for the country, but when I listen to our cities and mayors, they say we're over capacity. And it's making our cities and towns dysfunctional. The mayor of North Adams says he's on the verge of becoming Detroit. And so as much as we want to be compassionate, there's also capacity.
Okay. Be careful with Detroit. I'm from Detroit. Okay. All right. This question, sir. The new Americans of agenda, as you pointed out, including some of your own employees, we've had a long history of integrating immigrants from all areas of the world. It's absolutely astounding when you hear the languages are spoken sometimes when you go to state parks. And they've fled for their survival, but they've also benefited from being home to one of the most
diverse immigrant populations in the nation. What policies would you put in place as governor to discourage what many consider nativist legislative policies or proposals like those that we've seen in Arizona, in Georgia, and even here in Massachusetts?
The immigrant population adds to the diversity and richness of our society and in our culture. Let me tell you a quick story. I was at a political event with a bunch of Republicans, and a fellow came up to me and he said, so if you're elected governor, what are you going to do for me? Those boats at some point have to raise their own anchor and set the sail and take the helm. But as governor, I want to make things equal across the board and not cater to or pander to individual groups.
Do you drive?
I do.
Okay. So this whole notion of safe driving, a very, very vociferous argument on both sides. So my question to you is, do you support allowing all Massachusetts residents to participate in the driver's licensing process regardless of immigration status? And if yes, what specifically would you do as governor to ensure that Massachusetts adopts such a policy?
Again, I make the distinction between legal and illegal. I would say yes for all those that are here legally and no for those who are here illegally. I testified at the State House against that particular bill. It is a touchy or emotional subject. There's a woman out my way who lost a son in a drunk driving accident. A legal immigrant was at the wheel, but he also had his six-year-old son next to him. And so when he was caught, he wasn't just guilty of vehicular homicide, but he was guilty of driving under the influence and not having a driver's license and a number of other things, and also reckless endangerment of his own six-year-old child. If he had a driver's license, what would that have done? It would have only meant that he would be guilty of one less crime. But if he had been prevented from coming here in the first place or done so legally, this poor woman's son would still be alive. So regardless of the title of the bill, safe driving, I don't think that it fosters safe driving.
Okay, and now we're going to do what, of course, we did not have a chance to do in this for the previous gubernatorial candidates, a two-minute closing, if you will.
Like I said earlier, I have two employees that are here legally, and I think that any consensus about this issue has to recognize two facts. One, is there a difference between legal and illegal immigration? At the State House in that rally that was talked about earlier, I quoted St. John Paul II, who said illegal immigration should be prevented. You know, how do we go about that? How do we care about those who are here already illegally? We have to come to some consensus about that. And the second thing that I would ask you all to consider is this. Is there a capacity? Can we afford to have an infinite number of people, legally or illegally, come to the state of Massachusetts or come to the country? And I would say that, yes, there is. I don't know what that number is. But it's these two things, legal and illegal, and is there a capacity? How many can we afford? Listen to our mayors of our cities and towns who are saying that they're overburdened and that they just cannot handle anymore. As compassionate as they want to be, it's a capacity issue. So I would leave the audience with those two things. Please consider, is there capacity, and is there a difference between legal and illegal immigration?
Mark Fisher, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. seems to be a wide sentiment. Let's now call upon Steve Grossman. You know his name. He's currently Treasurer and Receiver General of Massachusetts. He was a former chairman of the Democratic National Committee and of the Massachusetts Democratic Party, and he topped the Democratic Convention vote in June in Springfield. Okay, it's a pleasure. All right.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
We're gonna let, okay, we'll let folks. You heard the story of this gentleman in Fitchburg. He was driving home from a picnic with his wife and five children. We seem to know him at this point. And he was stopped by the state police and told his registration was expired. It was not, but he had problems with his license. He was driving with a license that was problematic. And he was taken into police custody. And he was detained for 5 months and released with an ankle bracelet last year. Tomorrow, he has an appointment with ICE. Mr. Grossman, if governor, what would you say to this gentleman, and how would you use your position to ensure that Massachusetts public safety policies promote the safety of all residents and do not lead to family separation and what many believe to be racial profiling?
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here. This is a critical question, and for me, when you have an opportunity to take a look at something called secure communities, and recognize, as I have, unlike our current Attorney General, that this is profoundly problematic and has driven families apart. It has torn families apart. More than 50% of the people who have been deported under secure communities have had no criminal record whatsoever. I think the message that I would send to him is that, first of all, a governor has to demonstrate moral leadership by speaking out against policies, wrong-headed policies like secure communities. And second of all, we have role models of courageous elected officials, Joe Curtatone, the mayor of the city in which I've done business and had my family business for 45 years, who stood up and said, henceforth, we are simply not going to participate. We are going to engage in a form of civil disobedience. Marty Walsh has said, equally important, in the city of Boston, our most important city, the flagship city, that he also will move toward denying secure communities as the public policy that he will adopt, adopting his own form of the Trust Act. And I do support the goals of the Trust Act, and we need to move in that direction. So what I would say to him is that so often Massachusetts has led the way, and when we have seen public policies that are simply wrong-headed, don't work, drive people apart, and create an environment of racial profiling and incarceration in ways that are profoundly unfair, that cut against the fundamental principle on which this country is based. There are four very simple words on the front of the Supreme Court of the United States. It's called equal justice under law. Those are the fundamental principles we need to maintain. And it is up to a governor to speak up, to use his power, to turn moral leadership into action, to turn it into legislation, and to take on the federal government if we need to take on the federal government. Even the federal government, even the Obama administration, which is record on the issue of deportation, I do not support and I do not condone, has acknowledged that secure communities doesn't work. It is up to Massachusetts, which has so often led the way, to lead the way on this, and we've got at least two major municipal officials who are doing that. I would like to be a governor who leads in exactly that form.
Let me ask you this question before transitioning to the second topic. Are there any circumstances where you would agree with detention, such as the detention of this gentleman, or would you even go further where you might agree with indefinite detention for some individuals?
I think it depends on the nature of the offense, but again, when more than 50% have been deported for no criminal record whatsoever, I think we have to recognize that while there are those who commit crimes, whether they're documented or undocumented, whether they're citizens or undocumented immigrants, that fundamentally we have blurred that distinction to the extent that we have created fear. I mean, the relationship between law enforcement and citizens is a fundamental principle. When we have a relationship that works, then I think our society works. When we have a relationship that's built on fear, and this man should, and has a, based on having been incarcerated for 5 months for what you described as being his quote-unquote offense, I say that's wrong, and I say that this law needs to be dramatically overhauled and reformed. That's why I support the goals of the Trust Act, and we work very hard to implement that. It's long overdue.
So this question, of course, when you're dealing with, when you're dealing with this whole notion of inclusion, access to state services, including language access, now, if elected government, what would you do to ensure that your administration, the Grossman administration, is compliant with language access requirements and that all residents can access public information and communicate with all state agencies?
Look, we have great models already. The English for New Bostonians program in the city of Boston has been a game changer for 1,000 to 1,200 immigrants a year. It's working. For 13 years, it's working. So let's take something that we see working and export it all over the state. I mean, if there are 16, perhaps more than that, but the figure that I use is 16,000 immigrants waiting for ESOL classes. I mean, Danny Rivera, who's a dear friend of mine who has endorsed my candidacy, I was in Lawrence recently, and I said, Dan, tell me about ESOL classes. He said, do you want the good news or the bad news? I said, I'll take the good news. He said, we have 1,200 people enrolled in classes. I said, what's the bad news? He said, we have 1,000 on the waiting list. Then the same day, I went to a company in Lawrence called Selectria. It's a wonderful company, an emerging growth company, a clean technology company that will grow from 200 employees to as many as 500 employees over the next 3 to 5 years. One of the great winners right in Lawrence. So I talked to the leadership of the company. I said, tell me about the people who work here who don't have English language skills. They said, well, if you don't have English language skills, you can work here. We need you. But you won't make much more than $11 or $12 an hour. But if you learn English, if you have ESOL classes, you can become a manager. You can play a leadership role. There is no limit. What I think we're talking about here is limitless possibilities for those who have English language skills. So whether it is the program here in the city of Boston, whether it's the waiting list that we have to clear, whether it's the English Language Learners Bill, which is a wonderful piece of legislation, hasn't passed yet, but we need this to pass, it will dramatically improve access and opportunity, narrow the gap in terms of employment. This is Senator Sal DiDomenico from Everett. This is Representative Jeff Sanchez from Boston. And finally, I'm a huge believer that we need to do much more in terms of bringing interpreters and translators into all of our public places so that those who don't have those skills will be able to navigate the very difficult pathway that exists in state government. We place barriers and roadblocks in the way of people who want to navigate our system of government. We need to level that playing field.
And so you mentioned Lawrence, certainly one of the great immigrant communities in the state. Home to immigrants of all over Latin America, but particularly the Caribbean, people from the Dominican Republic. And I'm wondering what policies you would put in place as governor to discourage the type of legislative proposals that we've seen in Arizona that many describe as nativist. Those policies we've also seen in Georgia, and such proposals have even been made in Massachusetts. And what policies would you put in place to position new Americans to succeed in the great state of Massachusetts?
So my father used to have an expression. He used to say, words are words and promises are promises, but only performance is reality. So this is less about what would I do as governor prospectively, but I'd like to share just for a moment or two what I've done as state treasurer, because it matters what you've done. I made a promise to the people of Massachusetts when I was sworn in on January 19th of 2011. I said two things. First of all, we'll hire the best people for every job, because that's the way it should be, hire the best people. And second of all, I said hiring would reflect the diversity of the society in which we live. I'm proud to tell you that 35% of the people we've hired at Treasury and at the Mass State Lottery are people from diverse backgrounds. But beyond that, I was a business owner for 35 years. and I knew how we succeeded. So I had roundtable discussions all over the state with small business owners. I had one in Springfield. I had Carlos Gonzalez, the head of the Latino Chamber of Commerce, pull one together. I asked one question. What are the roadblocks and barriers you face as a small business owner, and how can we remove those barriers? And I listened to the answer. Access to capital, technical assistance, help with permitting and regulation, help with healthcare expenses. So I thought about that a little bit, and I said, let's do something dramatic. Let's bring back hundreds of millions of dollars from overseas, put it in Massachusetts banks, and let's loan that money to small businesses, and let's focus on businesses that are owned by women, diverse communities, immigrants, and veterans. What's happened? In 3.5 years, we have put $365 million into more than a third of the banks in the state, over 9,000 loans, with over $1 billion in loans. A man named Leo Chantre, Brazilian immigrant. Leo Chantre went to Bunker Hill Community College. He came from Brazil. He got his degree here. He went back to Brazil, met his wife, and they married. Came back here, started a business. Leo Chantre needed a loan to grow his business. He got a loan from the Cambridge Savings Bank. He's in Woburn. He's adding employees. He got his degree from Northeastern University, cum laude, with his children sitting there. Leo Chantre is a proud immigrant who's growing a business and creating jobs. Whether you're Leo Chantre or Agnes Young at Adcatron, or whether you're El Valle de la Sultana in East Boston, or whether you're any other small business and immigrant-owned business, you should have access to capital and access to all the resources. My goal as governor is to create one Commonwealth, level the playing field, and leave no one behind. And that's about public policies that include people and that give people access. We have changed public policy at the Treasurer's Office. We created a diversity and outreach council. We don't just have men and women of color and immigrant communities, but we have a person on our staff, on our committee, who represents all of the new Africans in Boston. Africans in Boston. The 100,000 people who are Africans, because everybody should have a right to succeed and grow and develop, flourish, and realize his or her potential. That's the promise of Massachusetts. That's the promise of America.
Mr. Grossman, access to driver's licenses for undocumented workers in this country has proven to be a very, very controversial issue from Georgia to Massachusetts, from Georgia to California. I'm wondering, do you support allowing all Massachusetts residents to participate in the driver's licensing process regardless of their immigration status? And if yes, what specifically would you do as governor to ensure that Massachusetts adopts such a policy? And I ask that, of course, in the context that there's a lot of pushback against such proposals.
So, fundamental principle. First, every immigrant should have the right to a driver's license. And the piece of legislation that regrettably Tricia Farley Bouvier from Pittsfield and Pat Jalen from Somerville were not able to get through to its final passage, we're going to bring that back. And I will advocate for that. And I will go to every corner of this Commonwealth. And you know, when I'm the nominee of the Democratic Party and I go up against Charlie Baker in a debate, I will advocate for driver's licenses for all immigrants. And if I don't get elected governor and people say, Steve, the reason you fell short was because there were too many people in Massachusetts who disagreed with you about driver's licenses, I promise you, I will put my head down on the pillow for the rest of my life and say I did the right thing. This is a fundamental issue of fairness and decency, and look, it's a public safety issue. Raise your hand if you think it would be a good idea for people to drive on the streets of this state without a license, without driver's testing, without driver's ed, and without insurance. Raise your hand if you think that would be a good idea. Of course it's not a good idea. We have people who go to work and they drive. We have people who need to go to the supermarket and shop. We have people who need to take their kids. They have to go to a doctor's appointment. They need a driver's license. And this also has another piece to it, and that is some people who fundamentally say we shouldn't allow in-state tuition for undocumented immigrants or children of undocumented immigrants because it'll cost us money. That is so wrong. There are 300,000 people who go to our 29 public colleges and universities. For the few hundred people who will go growing to 700 or 800. Mass Taxpayers Foundation did a study. They said not only would it not cost our public colleges and universities any money, not only would it not take a seat away from anybody else, but it will actually add revenue to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So over the next 5 to 7 years, you will ramp up so you'll have $5 to $7 million of revenue coming in. Better educated kids, able to take their place, able to contribute to the innovation economy. Fundamental principle, don't leave any child behind. And the final principle is universal pre-K. 25,000 children woke up in Massachusetts this morning and they have no place to go to learn. And most of them are in the older industrial cities, heavy immigrant population. Every 3- and 4-year-old should have a chance to go, to learn how to read, to grow, develop, to flourish, to realize his or her full potential. That's a fundamental principle of a Grossman administration.
All right. So, Mr. Grossman, a minute and 30 seconds to summarize. We used up 30 seconds of that.
So, I thank you for all being here today. This is an issue that is so important to all of us. There are over 1 million people who live in Massachusetts who weren't born in this country. My grandfather came here in 1900, 114 years ago. He was an immigrant, second youngest of 13 kids, never got past the sixth grade. His mother said, Max, you gotta go to work. He shined shoes, sold newspapers, finally got a job as a delivery boy. But he had a dream for his life. He had a dream for his life. And the dream was to own his own business. Years later, he took me to lunch and he said, Steve, there are only 4 things I cared about in my life. I wanted to raise a healthy family. I wanted to educate my children. I want to own my own business and give something back to the community. The fundamental principles of a good, rich, full life. Family, career, and don't forget the community. Every one of you is here tonight because you are a citizen. What Mike Dukakis says is the highest calling. You're citizens, we care, we have an opportunity. We have an opportunity to make Massachusetts the best, the most welcoming place, with compassion, with social and economic justice. And when we do that, we will realize the full promise of what Richard Florida said in his seminal book called The Rise of the Creative Class. When he said that a society that is open and welcoming and tolerant to all is a society that will succeed beyond its wildest imagination. We have an opportunity to create jobs, opportunity, great education, and do things in our time, in this society. Immigrant entrepreneurship has been the backbone of Massachusetts for 400 years. In this time, on my watch as governor, it will continue to be that. Thank you so much.
Steve Grossman. Thank you, Steve. I appreciate it. Now, we're waiting for Jeff McCormick. Ah, there you are. Jeff, okay. Thank you very much. All right. It's a pleasure, Jeff. All right. Okay. Short introduction here. Jeff, thank you. Jeff McCormick is an independent, and he studied molecular genetics at Syracuse University, but he made his mark with his MBA founding Saturn Partners, a finance firm specializing in capitalizing early-stage companies. You're a businessman and a scientist. Okay. And you also are someone who thinks about a lot of these issues, including immigration, obviously.
Absolutely.
Now, you've heard the story about the young man who was stopped, and so we don't have to repeat it.
I've been here from the beginning.
You've been the beginning? Okay. So the question is, what would you say to him? And another question, what would you say to his family if there was the possibility of prospect that he might be deported after having been detained for 5 months and now wearing an ankle bracelet? What would be your policy as governor in terms of halting what many consider to be racial profiling and policies that that affect individuals of this sort coming back from a park and suddenly brought into detention?
Well, let's start with that. Second part of it first, racial profiling, there's just no acceptance for that, period, end of discussion. So that is just open and shut. When it comes to pulling someone aside for what is a minor infraction, and this to me ultimately is a failure of the federal government, right? We don't have clear rules and regulations here. So we've got to use our head. And I think in this Commonwealth, we're smarter than what we did, honestly. I think we've got to look at the situation and say, okay, this is a member of a community who, you know, has a family, has roots, and there doesn't seem anything with what I know about the details, as we've been given them, that would justify the actions we took. I think it's extraordinarily heavy-handed. And I have to tell you, I've been building companies for 27 years. We have hundreds and hundreds of employees of companies that are extraordinary contributors to those companies, leaders. And I'm not talking, manufacturing companies. I mean software companies, biotech companies, you name it. CTOs, CEOs, CFOs of these companies. So they're a really important part of what we do every day. And I recognize that. And I think in a Commonwealth like Massachusetts, we've got to be smarter. I mean, that's what we're about. That's our brand. Let's be smart. Let's be sensitive to these issues.
Now, of course, a lot of these laws are federal laws. And the whole notion of trying to supersede federal laws is that in itself can be problematic because you get yourself in trouble at times with the federal government. So how would you joust with the government, the federal government, over their predilection as opposed to your predilection as governor on detention issues of this sort?
Well, at the end of the day, the federal government can have a very heavy hand. I mean, there's no question about it. But you have to go to bat. And this is a very important state in national politics for both sides for different reasons. And I think as a governor, there are times in life you just have to step up and say, this is what we think the right thing to do. You have to use a bully pulpit. You have to get people behind you to do the right thing. And with the as high a percentage of Massachusetts, with this the immigrant community, you could get a lot of people behind you very, very quickly on an issue like this.
If you were governor, Mr. Fisher,
Fisher. That's okay.
My apologies. Yeah, there's so many candidates.
Did that sound like a Mark Fisher answer?
No, you don't sound like anything. Right. This question, Mr.
Steve, McCormick. Help me out here.
Yeah, thank you. This question. Now, you heard the emotion around this border issue, children coming across the border.
Absolutely.
From Guatemala and Honduras, El Salvador, ending up in U.S.-Mexico border. Some of them might have come to Massachusetts to be housed under a federal program. What would you have done under those circumstances if you had the opportunity to house children?
First of all, this again is a very political issue. There's no question about how it hit the surface and how it disappeared as quickly as it did. There's no doubt about that. What I said is we've got to talk to these local communities right away, and we have to ask them if they have the resources to support these children. And the overwhelming response very quickly was people saying, we don't have the resources. We have school budgets are stretched. We're getting the Prop 2.5 overrides. People are up in arms about them, et cetera, et cetera. And I think a lot of it came down to a total distrust of the federal government that they were going to put something in place long enough term that they actually would pay for it. But at the end of the day, even if the federal government is paying for it, they're paying for it out of our tax dollars, our collective tax dollars. And what bothered me most is there are so many needy people in this Commonwealth right now. And all the candidates, we've been everywhere. I mean, we've traveled all over this Commonwealth. And, it pains me to give money to veterans when I walk to work. It pains me to have to feed people by the hundreds at Pine Street Inn. So the need is there. And we've got to say to ourselves, at what point do we break? And I have seen poverty on a scale that most people in this room have never seen. I'm talking the slums of Mumbai, the mud hut slums of Africa. It is extraordinary. The world's needs are infinite. There's no doubt about it. So we have to figure out what is our role as a society in that.
Now, Jeff McCormick, there's some who would argue that we actually have though we don't have infinite resources, that we have resources enough to, that there's enough for everybody. Do you subscribe to that argument that if we wanted to, if the state put its mind to it, its resources to it, they could in fact afford to house children under those circumstances if it became necessary?
Well, you're making it a state issue, and you know what? In my family, this was my wife and I, Christine, we said, what if it were more of a private issue? What if we could get people to rally, people with the means to do it, and say, I want to help personally? So she said to me, Jeff, let's take two of these children in, and we will take care of them as long as we need to take care of them. If it's through college, it's through college, you know? And I thought, you know, that is a really interesting kind of solution. And I have friends that are on these ridiculous waiting lists to adopt children. You know, can you imagine that? If America just said, you know what, we're gonna take care of this privately, and we're not gonna burden a lot of these gateway cities. And remember, a lot of it would be cities that already are extremely stretched with a population that they just can't serve well.
This probably suggests why you're an independent candidate. It doesn't, that doesn't, that reflects neither the a Democratic platform position or a Republican platform position, am I correct?
Yeah, it's a creative solution, and that's what I do in my life. All these companies that, you know, that we've been successful with, when we started them out, people thought we were nuts. Constant Contact, they thought we were nuts. Boston Duck Tours, they thought we were really crazy with that. It's been very successful.
Well, let's talk about resources. If elected governor, what would you do to ensure your administration's compliant with language access requirements and that all residents can access public information and communicate with all state agencies? That obviously requires some money.
Well, I've traveled the world so many times, and I've been in many, many places that I don't speak the language. And I can't imagine if I went to China or if I went to Russia, couldn't speak the language, and I've had a lot of education, and I just couldn't be productive. So I am certainly someone who would need the help to be a strong contributor to society. There's no doubt about it. But I have a lot of potential, right? And that's the way I look at immigrant populations as well. And because I have had the direct firsthand experience with so many people in our portfolio companies that have created extraordinary value, and by the way, when you create a lot of value, you create a lot of jobs. And if you remember anything about my campaign, it should be Jeff for Jobs. I mean, that's what I want to do.
No, Jeff, Mr. McCormick. Yep. I don't know you that well. No, I'm just.
Just don't call me Mark, okay?
All right, I won't call you Mark. A New Americans agenda. You have people on your staff, you see, who are New Americans, who work for your company. So you've seen this history in action, integrating immigrants from all over the world, including refugees who fled for their survival. We have Rwandans here, for example, Cambodians here. What policies would you put in place as governor to discourage, and in very important word, nativist legislation proposals like those we've seen in Arizona, for example?
Well, first of all, I think a governor just has to veto any policy that even hints at that. And end of discussion. You know, I think that's the very first place to start. But there's other things that we need to do, there's some things that haven't come into the conversation tonight that I think are really, really important. I think we ought to rethink our healthcare policy. I think there are things like deductibles and co-pays, especially for primary care. Okay, so primary care long-term will save money in healthcare and get people the best outcomes. So now we're gonna create a disincentive for people to do the thing that is most beneficial and drives the most value in healthcare. It just makes no sense at all to me. And unfortunately, immigrants are burdened with, you know, those very kinds of issues. And again, they're creating disincentives for people, they're hurting people. They're preventing people from working and having productive lives.
And so how would you basically sustain Massachusetts' commitment to inclusive access to health care What specifically would you do?
Well, specifically what we need to do, first of all, the state is a huge healthcare consumer. It's 42% of the state's budget, right? So the state is the gorilla consumer. And when you're a big consumer, you can dictate the terms. Because that happens to us, because we've got all these little companies, and believe me, all these Fortune 500 companies are doing it to us all the time, right? So you can change behavior. And by the way, the providers, they know that this is where the world needs to go. They know they have to bring down the cost. They know we can't continue to have healthcare costs as high as they are.
Final question. Do you support allowing all Massachusetts residents to participate in the driver's licensing process, regardless of immigration status, undocumented or documented?
Before I answer that, let me tell you the way I look at any problem, any opportunity. I'm trained as a scientist and as an analyst. I talk to the experts. I talk to, I do the 360. I talk to immigrants. I talk to people in the insurance business. I talk to people in law enforcement. And what was very interesting is the patrolmen and the state troopers and the sheriffs I talked to, they said, Jeff, would you rather have safe drivers on the road or not? You know, that's what this comes down to. You know, immigration issues are a separate issue. Just look at the training people would have, look at the safety, the insurance people say it's the only way they're going to get insurance. So to me, it seems like a no-brainer when you do it that way. And I think as governor, the next governor ought to get law enforcement to stand up and say, you know what, this is just smart. This is going to help people, and I think you framed it extremely well. Who would choose the opposite, right? I truly don't see where the argument here is.
Okay, Jeff, why don't you take 2 minutes and sum up your position?
So, I look at the world as obviously as an optimist because I'm an entrepreneur. You know, one of those people who goes just kind of 24/7 to create companies and create jobs. We've done it in energy, we've done it in healthcare, we've done it in biotech, software, occasionally a crazy company like Boston Duck Tours. And we just try and solve problems. We're doing it in education. I found out that the number one reason why young men of color drop out of high school is struggling in math. Well, we have a math software company right now. We teach millions of kids math in 41 different states. And they get much higher math scores in a year, 30% higher scores. So we keep kids in school, we get rid of chronic unemployment, we decrease the rates of incarceration. To me, that's a solution. And that's what I want to do as governor. Just apply a skill set of getting to the bottom, which at the end of the day, a lot of it is about people having opportunity and access to a lot of good jobs. That's what I've done in my private sector life. That's what I want to do in my public sector life, create jobs and opportunity for people. And thanks all of you so much for taking the time out tonight to hear this.
Jeff McCormick.
Thank you.
Jeff, I'm glad I got a chance to know you. Okay, we're waiting for the Attorney General. And she's here? Okay. Jeff, thank you very much. See, I've gotten to know him. Call him Jeff now. This is your seat.
All right.
Exactly.
Super. Thank you.
Okay. And we round off the outer hour with the Attorney General of Massachusetts, Martha Coakley. She's a 2010 Democratic nominee from Massachusetts for the U.S. Senate and currently leads most polls for governor as we head into the Democratic Party primary on Tuesday, September 9th, just a few weeks from now, about less than 4 weeks from now. And the question of immigration, of course, is a question we've been dealing with all night. And you may not have heard this story about a fellow named Josue, who was a member of the Committee de Vecinos in Fitchburg. He was driving home from a picnic with his wife and five children when he was stopped by the state police. And he was told that his registration had expired. It had not expired, but there was a problem with his license. And so he was detained by the state police, detained for 5 months. He was equipped with an ankle bracelet after a major outcry by communities around the state because they felt he had been separated from his wife and five children. And he essentially was told that in order to keep his family together, he would basically have to answer to immigration officials. They're going to make a decision tomorrow or sometime within the next few weeks whether or not he's going to stay in this country or leave this country. In other words, he has an appointment with ICE and he's worried that he may be ordered to leave the country, and his family and his children, I'm told, have suffered psychologically from this experience. And his whole family, apparently, I'm told, is more terrified of the police than ever before. And my question to you, Attorney General, is, if governor, what would you say to this gentleman? And how would you use your position as governor to ensure that Massachusetts public safety policies promote the safety of all residents and do not lead to families separating and racial profiling?
And certainly you can understand the stress on the family and the individual involved here. That is exactly the set of circumstances, type of circumstances that I know, as I have talked to folks since last September, that have raised concerns on the issues around secure communities and what that federal program is doing, and on a more local level, even without that, what are we doing to make sure that people who are here in Massachusetts are safe? So just by way of background, my experience as district attorney has been, regardless of the status of victims or defendants who are charged, that they are entitled to a fair system, representation of counsel. I would hope that this gentleman involved has counsel for him. He should if he doesn't. And that we understand, as I do as attorney general, that people who are working deserve to get paid. In other words, when we go after companies who violate people's rights, we don't focus on the status of workers, we focus on the companies and their compliance with the law. This particular piece about how we will continue to keep our communities safe is I had hoped by now we would have a solution at the federal level. We do not. And just as we did with the Cambodian community in Lowell and with the Haitian community in Cambridge, we have worked in the district attorney's office and the attorney general's office to make sure that with language translation, with understanding cultural competency that's required, we provide the ability for people not only to be safe, but to feel safe in their communities. And this concern about what is happening, mostly because we've had no solution at the federal level, clearly pushes down now to the states. The need to be engaged, and for this particular gentleman, to have counsel and to insist upon what his rights should be. Obviously, there are facts I don't know in this circumstance, but it doesn't sound like that is either the goal, nor should it be the result of federal action that is masquerading as some kind of secure communities. That wasn't the original goal of the federal program. It's not what it should be doing now, and I'm glad to hear that at the federal level, Jay Johnson has said he will review this to determine what that mission is, and I think that all states, including I as next governor, would work with our Executive Office of Public Safety, with our immigrant community, with advocates around making sure that both what the federal government says it's doing and what it's actually doing is consistent with what we want for our safety and our security in our communities here in Massachusetts.
Attorney General Coakley, now I'm going to ask you three additional questions, main questions within our allotted time, but I'm just going to sneak in this question as well. It's called secure communities, the purposely called secure communities. That is supposed to resonate in our minds. Are there any circumstances in which you feel that undocumented individuals should be detained?
I think what the original purpose of secure communities was, and the way in which it was adopted first by Mayor Menino and Ed Davis, who was the chief of police at the time, was to allow for the securing of the most dangerous of predators, who were often, as we know, preying upon those in their own community, an immigrant community, for instance, where the threat to a victim, a domestic violence victim, or the victim of a robbery, who's of the same community that don't go to the police because you'll be deported, meant it was very difficult for those communities to feel safe. That was the basis on which it was first adopted in Boston. It was adopted at that level. And my understanding from listening anecdotally to people and looking what's happened is that that eventually became a program that was different and other than what I just described. Clearly, if people are dangerous, they need to be detained. We want to protect our public safety, but there should be no difference between whether people are here undocumented or whether they are citizens of the United States. So the criminal justice system should act fairly in those circumstances.
Let me ask you this question about inclusive access to state services. If elected governor, what would you do to ensure your administration is compliant with language access requirements and that all residents can access public information and communicate with all state agencies? And how would you sustain Massachusetts' commitment to inclusive access to healthcare, education, and social services?
So let's start with the healthcare, education, social services, because that's incredibly important. That is our way in which, at the state level particularly, and with local authorities, we provide for prevention, for community health care, for making sure that there is both the cultural competency and the language ability for all people who need access to health care. Let's start with that. We've done better in Massachusetts, but we should do more, because without language ability and availability and access, then health care is effectively denied. We don't provide access without that. We've done through our not-for-profits, and I hope as we move in Massachusetts towards more community preventive health care, the ability to work in the communities, that means having on staff everybody from someone at the reception desk to someone to the doctors and nurses to the medical profession, the people who are going to be able to understand the community they serve. In terms of education, we understand that the state needs to be able to provide for all of our students, including our adult basic education, the ability for language services that will allow access to that education. Otherwise, it's a meaningless, there's no teeth to it, it's meaningless unless we provide access through education, through the language ability and otherwise. Through social service, the same way. I think the next governor has an opportunity to say, through our DCF and our DMH, Department of Mental Health, and Children and Family Services, that we break down silos, and that includes the silos that we need for problem solving with families and kids who need help. We should have more help in our schools, and that means with language access and making sure that we're able to provide the services in the language with the understanding of the communities that we serve. I have seen that in my work as an assistant DA in Lowell, in Somerville, in Cambridge, as a district attorney, certainly through all of Middlesex County, where in Malden alone, we have over 70 languages that are spoken within that high school. And so the state has to and can work with the local communities to make sure that, particularly in those three areas, the communities that are here in Massachusetts that we need to serve, particularly around education, but also with healthcare and social services, we are able to do that effectively.
Now, all of your fellow candidates have expressed strong opinions, supportive of integrating immigrants from all areas of the world, including refugees who fled for their survival, all but with caveat of Mr. Fisher. In talking about integrating these diverse immigrant populations in the nation, what policies would you put in place as governor to discourage what many describe as nativist legislative proposals, like those we've seen in Arizona, for example, Georgia's another state, and even in Massachusetts? And what policies would you put in place to position new Americans to succeed in our state?
Well, first of all, I'd like to think that that risk in Massachusetts is much less than it might be in Arizona or some of the other states where we've seen a very unfortunate anti-immigrant, very hostile both on the ground and in the legislative arena. I think Massachusetts, and certainly we know this working in our Civil Rights Division or in the Attorney General's office, our job is not only to make sure that we don't discriminate against people, but that we're inclusive. And that's true depending upon your origin, depending upon whether you are hearing impaired, depending upon whether you are disabled in some other way. We have looked at a population that is here and say, how do we provide access, and how do we make sure that the inclusion of the population, and for new Americans, for immigrants who are here, that includes things we just talked about. I would like to think that the next Attorney General would work with the next governor to make sure that legislation like that would not get passed. If it was, that it could be challenged. The Attorney General has the ability to look at and challenge, as we have federal statutes, whether it's the Defense of Marriage Act or other acts that we think aren't fair. And it's also making sure that not only do those statutes not get passed, if they do, they get challenged, but that within an agency, within the application of what the policies are, you set that tone from the top, and that you are able to, through inclusion in your cabinet, through inclusion in the people who work for the state, that you are able to have that conversation with people in Massachusetts and make sure that we are in, as we indicated, education, social work, particularly healthcare, including people in that process. That includes in the political system, with better representation for people at every level, so that their voices are going to be heard at the table.
Briefly, Attorney General Coakley, what is your view about undocumented immigrants receiving driver's licenses in this state? What's your view about that as a policy?
So we've had a lot of discussion on this during the course of this campaign, and I have said that I am open to ways that we can do what I know other states have looked at, and I've started to take a look at what other states have been able to do. I have said, and in the past, I have been opposed to that, but it is clear to me that people who need to get to work, people who have medical emergencies, and particularly because we have no national solution to pathways to immigration for people and families who have been here paying taxes, working hard, we clearly have to find a way to do that. Whatever that best way is, I have said to Mira and to other groups that I've talked to, I'm willing to work with them on how we do that. And one thing that I'd like to say tonight, because I've thought a lot about how we do that, I've looked at proposed statutes that are pending. I think there's some pluses and minuses to the language. You know, I'm a lawyer, so I look at how the language works and also what some of the consequences will be. But one thought that would make much of this, I think, more effective and quicker would be for, if I'm elected governor, to have a director of immigration and safety in our communities. In other words, someone directly who could work interagency and directly with me and directly with advocacy groups, particularly on how do we pave the way for safe driving, making sure that people can have licenses, have the proper registration, and what is the best way to do it? Which state has done it best? Which way do we do it without unintended consequences? And also would help us address some of the issues that you started out with the gentleman who's been detained. And how is it that Massachusetts can best protect both safety and inclusion of everybody who's here?
Some experts, this is just a final question, some experts have concluded that the fissures in our immigration policy on a national level have basically exacerbated problems of human trafficking. What would you do to, if you will, to address that issue as it exists in our state?
Well, much to my dismay, it came to my attention that we were one of three states in Massachusetts that had no anti-human trafficking statute. And when we first started talking about this issue, people said, well, why do we need it? We don't have any trafficking here in Massachusetts. Of course, we know otherwise, both sex trafficking and labor trafficking. I saw that first actually when I did child abuse work, and I saw young women who might have come into the system as defendants, but who actually had been victimized and trafficked on the street, sometimes in a more organized way, sometimes by a boyfriend or by another family member. We now have a very strong anti-human trafficking statute, both for labor and sex. We have worked on cases already with the federal government and bringing awareness of this as one of the biggest growing and lucrative industries. People know they sell guns, they sell drugs, they're gone. They can sell young women particularly, and also young men again and again, and the availability of that on the internet. But I think that is something that is very underground right now, but certainly not invisible. And we need to work in Massachusetts to educate people that it exists. We need to work with emergency rooms. We need to work across the state so people can see trafficking victims. They don't see them now. And make sure that we use our state and our federal resources both for holding those accountable who would traffic in people, and also making resources available to victims of trafficking, many of whom have been in for a long time and may be either domestic or from other countries. And we don't have the resources yet to do that, but I'm committed to making sure we do.
All right, and why don't you take 2 minutes to summarize your position, if you will, on immigration?
Sure. You know, I think as we move forward out of a tough recession here, and we look at a Massachusetts that I think can be prosperous and fair, that we turn this economy around for everybody who's here, not just Wall Street, not just people in Boston and Cambridge and parts of Boston and Cambridge, but for the whole state, and for everybody who is here who wants to work hard, who wants a good education, who wants to be part of what this country has always been, is a way to, as my dad did, work his way through college and believe in education for his kids, find a way for all of our kids in Massachusetts to find a dream and to follow it. And that means being inclusive in education, including in-state tuition, as the governor has, making sure that all of our children have access to early education. The schools that will give them that, make sure they have opportunities for English language studies, if that's what they want, that we have an open mind here in Massachusetts as we move forward. And I think that with the advocacy groups here, with the incredible interest, I think, in the innovation economy, we do have that opportunity to make sure we can turn this economy around for everybody, education for everybody. We can be prosperous and fair in a way that includes people who are here who I believe are an important part of our culture and our future. So thank you very much.
Attorney General Martha Coker, thank you. Well, folks, I got to tell you, thank you. I'd like to thank you for being here, first of all, and thanks to the event sponsors, the Massachusetts Immigrant and Refugee Advocacy Coalition, and to Bunker Hill Community College, and of course to our candidates, and President Ittinger. I want to thank you tremendously for your support and for helping to bring this together. And I'd like you to come up, please. Thanks. And thanks, look, thanks also to all the co-sponsors and endorsers, the candidates and the audience, and I'm reading all this. Republicans and Democrats, please remember to vote in your chosen party September 9th primary. Very important to vote. Less than 3 weeks away, folks, and we hope this evening has helped everyone in their decision making as we close in on the November 4th, 2014 election for governor of Massachusetts. And I'd like to thank you again, and I'd like you to say a last word, if you will.
Don't forget to vote, and hopefully we will have another session once the primaries are over, so we can hear the next part of the contest. So good night, everybody. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
I didn't have to turn it off.
Oh, don't worry, I don't either. Thank you.
This was good.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.